Good. That's awesome. Some energy would be awesome. How are we doing tonight? Woo! Nice. All right. Thank you so much for joining us for this evening's Millennium Stage performance. We're so happy to have you and the Duke Ellington School of the Arts. It's always an honor to work with them. I did want to let you know, after the performance, we have a performance pollster in a purple shirt in the back of the house. He'd love to get information about your experience with the performance tonight, so feel free to stop with him after the show and check in, fill out a quick survey. I did want to alert everyone in the house tonight that there are some scenes with strong language and mature content, so please be advised as you're watching the performance about that. Now, here to give another introduction about tonight's performance is Mark Williams, the chair of the LMC program at the Duke Ellington School of the Arts. Please welcome him to the stage.
Good evening. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, we don't like energy. A couple of things I wanted to say. First off, I wanted to thank the Kennedy Center for this and another one of the myriad of opportunities that they provide the Duke Ellington School of the Arts, and in particular, Jeanette McEwen, who's also a board member at the Ellington School of the Arts. She really is a clear example of somebody who's vested in cultivating artists. Second, I'd like to thank a woman who, in an assembly at Ellington, said one of the most profoundly beautiful and useful things I've ever heard in my 25 years in education. She said, and I quote, "You decide what goes in your head." That woman is also going to see a school, a dream, sort of reach its logical conclusion. That woman is Peggy Cooper Kafritz, the co-founder of the Duke Ellington School of the Arts, is right here. Peggy, could you raise your hand? Thank you. So before we begin, Martha Graham said the body can do what words can't. I love that quote because it makes me mad at her. But also, what you're about to see is an attempt to link the language and movement together. The artists that I revere most are never one thing. Miles Davis was a visual artist when he sketched Spain. James Baldwin was a jazz musician when he wrote Sonny's Blues. Baryshnikov as a poet just by standing on a stage. So this is an attempt, an experiment, an ongoing experiment with the wonderful director, Miss Nikki Sutton, who's leading the dance pieces, is to look at those intersections where language and movement merge and what can happen in that. And then the overarching narrative in the evening is a quote from one of our writers, Tyrese Rowe, who said, "Fighting for the people that you love is much harder and fighting for the people that you don't." Thank you.
In the morning and I ask myself, is life worth living, should I blast myself? I'm tired of being poor and even worse, I'm black. My stomach hurts, so I'm looking for a purse to snatch. Cops give a damn about a negro. Pull a trigger, kill a nigga, he's a hero. Get it back to the kids, who the hell cares? One less hungry mouth on the welfare. First ship him, don't let him deal with brothers. Give him guns, step back, watch him kill each other. It's time to fight back, that's what Huey said. Two shots in the dark, now Huey's dead. I got love for my brother, but we can never go nowhere unless we share with each other. We gotta start making changes. Learn to see me as a brother instead of two distant strangers. And that's how I'm supposed to be. How can the devil take a brother if he's close to me? I let it go back to when we played as kids, but then it changed. That's the way it is. Come on, come on.
That's just the way it is. Things will never be the same. That's just the way it is. Oh, yeah. That's just the way it is. Things will never be the same. That's just the way it is. Oh yeah.
I see no changes. All I see is racist faces. Misplaced hate makes disgrace to racists. We under. I wonder what it takes to make this one better place. Let's erase the wasted.
about the people, they'll be acting right. Cause both black and white and smoke a crack tonight. And the only time we chill is when we kill each other. It takes skill to be real time to heal each other. And although it seems evident, we ain't ready to see a black president. It ain't a secret, don't conceal the fact. The penitentiary's packed and it's filled with blacks. But some things will never change. Try to show another way, but you're staying in the dope game. Now tell me what's a mother to do. Being real don't appeal to the brother in you. You gotta operate the easy way.
I made a cheat today.
But you made it in a sleazy way. Sell it back to the kids.
I gotta get paid.
Well, hey, well, that's the way it is. Come on. Come on.
That's just the way it is. Things will never be the same. That's just the way it is. Oh, yeah.
Start making some changes. Let's change the way we eat. Let's change the way we live. And let's change the way we treat each other. You see, the old way wasn't working, so it's on us to do what we gotta do to survive. And still I see no changes. Can a brother get a little peace?
Trinidad, D.C. Notorious for back when drugs and gangs ruled the streets. People were afraid to leave their homes, but the people in the row homes grew up together, their parents instilling that southern hospitality they carried with them. But now, there's no beat, no song, no hotheads, drive-bys, swift feet, hugs, or laughter. The 70s, 80s, 90s, today, 2010s, silence. It makes me uncomfortable. For sale on every corner. The black families who once stood outside rocking, talking, waving are now gone. Either dead, jailed, or kicked out for new owners. Ever since the school across the street caught on fire and was rebuilt, the street has changed. The houses seem taller, less color. No one talks to each other. The walls of the homes are thin, and still you hear nothing from no one. No names, no laughter, nothing. Is gentrified.
Oh, she may be weary.
There is nothing after love.
Young girls, they do get weary.
Human connection is our only story.
Wearing that same old shaggy dress.
We distract ourselves from it with what we believe to be a formidable foe to the allure of the wanted.
But when she gets weary.
Politics, labor left alienated, the collection of meaningless trivia and a futile attempt to smother our nature. As reinforcement, we disguise this infamous monomyth as entertainment.
Try a little tenderness.
Each innovation of art further removing the artist from the words they suppress. The birth of celebrity killed the griot.
You know she's waiting.
And with that, a line was drawn between the hunter and the gatherer.
Just anticipating.
I live in the moments between birthdays.
The thing that you never, never, never possess.
That annual winter morning where love removes its mask. My family, huddled around the breakfast table, eat cake and laugh. Their voices sing, and the night becomes dedicated to the waning minutes of this ever-so-gay jubilee. The in-between, however, is monotonous.
While she's there waiting.
There is no separation, no authenticity, just routine and absent-minded traveling. Each day feels closer to an end goal. An epilogue of my trials that consciously I know to be nothing more than faithful
try
fiction.
Try a little tenderness.
But yet, no matter how nihilistic I convince myself I am, I cannot rid myself of the inescapable yearning. I treat each mile marker as if it was an X that marks the spot. A first kiss, virginity lost, one day a last kiss, and eventually children. Each event shrouded in trickery, whispers of it being the final chapter, all to feed our blissful ignorance. There is no end, there is no beginning, and our interpretation of love is anything but public domain.
It's not just sentimental, no.
These physical manifestations of the love we cannot grasp become tomorrows following our slumber. Yesterday holds no value, and that is the trap. We fight and fight, but our petty resistance reinforces us as nothing more than the whores we are. Time has pimped us all, and we haven't even noticed.
She has her griefs and cares.
I remember that taxi ride home. As the afternoon moved forward, our group dwindled and intimacy triumphed. You weren't wearing a seatbelt.
But the words, they are spoke so gently.
We let small talk act as a carrier for the parasite found deep in the undercurrents. We stopped in front of your house and you kissed my cheek, simple yet evil. Unbeknownst to you, your complacency synthesized another milestone, a milestone I couldn't prepare for.
Makes it easier to bear.
It felt like the finish line. It forewent physicality and undermined everything I forced myself to accept. I felt it, the end of history.
You won't regret it, no, no.
But now it is nothing but a memory.
Young boys, they don't forget it.
And I've lost my obsession with recreation.
Love is their whole happiness.
I am a child.
It's all so simple.
But I won't be when I wake up.
Oh, you gotta do it.
So for now, I sleep in and move once the planet ceases to rotate.
Try a little tenderness.
There is nothing after love, but there is everything before it.
Mommy, I'm gonna go see a movie with a friend. It was the first week of winter break, and I decided I was running away from home, even though I hadn't packed anywhere near enough to survive a week in D.C. I was walking through one of the back alleys of Chinatown when I saw a man that I'd seen 20 minutes before in the metro. He told me that we were twins because we'd both poked holes in the too long sleeves of our sweaters. This time, he was flat on his back, convulsing. A woman in a purple fleece jacket and a Chinese busboy stood over him, watching through their fingers with this morbid interest that was somehow still distant, like they knew he was dying and cared enough to bear witness to the occasion, but not enough to intervene. The whole thing didn't take all that long. He started vomiting, mainly bile. He made a noise like a toilet backing up. Then he stopped moving. The woman started to cry right around the same time that the paramedics arrived. The boy was speaking in hurried Mandarin to someone on the phone, and I remember how grateful I felt when he lit a cigarette because the smell of the vomit had reached me where I stood 5 yards away, still in the alley. I also remember how disquieting my own revulsion was, how shocked I was that my body's response to an odor could somehow be stronger than my heart's response to death. I watched as the paramedic gently disentangled the fabric from his thumb, but then yanked his sleeve up with the carelessness that one only deals to the dead. He found what he was looking for. Half a dozen spots up and down his forearm. They didn't look like constellations. I tell myself sometimes when I have to silence the part of my brain that's romantic to the point of delusion. Actually, they looked a bit like the mosquito bites you might see on a kid who hasn't learned to stop picking his scabs. Sometimes that's worse. Police pulled up and I started to leave, this taut distrust of law enforcement and a hatred for tardiness steering me along. I found my friend standing in front of the Gallery Place movie theater, and she immediately struck up a largely one-sided conversation. See, the week before, I'd taken a CPR class, and after I successfully brought back the doll, the instructor told me that if I were ever to find someone in the same situation, I was legally obligated to try and help them. I was the daughter of two intellectuals who stressed the importance of practical knowledge as well as academic and related to too many drug addicts. I was morally obligated to try and stop people from dying, especially when the cause was something as undignified and easily prevented as vomit down a windpipe. And yet, when faced with the prospect of performing the Heimlich or just turning a man on his side, I stayed firmly planted like I had a point to prove. Remorse reached me with the same speed and acidity that the smell in the alley had. My friend asked me something, and I turned to face her and vomited with the gracelessness of the sincere. I stood there with my hands on my knees, overwhelmed with the quiddity of the situation, with the sheer irony of it all. I was gripped with this realization of how much I had in common with the miserable people who cried for dead strangers that they should have saved. My makeshift gloves were the same as a dead man's. My first instinct was to distance myself from controversial matters, whether it was standing 5 yards away or pretending like I'd been on the phone the whole time. And I was as slow to give a damn as the first responders who keep corpses company on Thursdays in December. We still saw the movie. I blame my retching on a bad hot dog that I didn't eat. It was terrible, some kind of sequel. Afterwards, we stood outside the theater, our hands clutching unevenly buttered popcorn, our rain boots ankle deep in snow. I saw someone die today. My voice caught, fell short of the casual tone that I'd been going for. I wanted to impress her. What? Her voice was high, it was childish, it slipped over me, making me more tired, making me forget why I'd come to meet her in the first place. Some junkie back there in the alleys, he was puking and I guess he choked on it because he stopped moving and they loaded him up in the back of the ambulance. My voice was breathy and I hated how young I sounded. This thing that I'd seen should have made me older. Oh my gosh, are you okay? Her voice kept climbing octaves, her blue eyes panicked and abnormally wide. Yeah, whatever, I'm fine, I didn't know him. I made my voice rounder in that low, rough way that I'd seen my dad do. She grabbed my wrist, her milky white hand a stark, ugly contrast against my tanner one. Sophia, she said, and her voice had this forced empathy laced with an unhinged panic in it. That was real, you're not dreaming. The movie we'd seen was some cheap Inception ripoff, and the subject of hallucination had lost all of its familiarity. And even though we were 11, the comparison was so offbeat in sixth grade that I couldn't help but laugh. Yeah, no shit. I was comfortable then, our hands clutched together, the awkward shift from her skin color to mine, reminding me of the places that we held in each other's lives, how she was light and panicked, and I was darker and calmer, because although my eyes were not as wide as hers, they'd seen more. No, like, listen, he was real. He had a family, and the comfort was gone as quickly as it had come. I couldn't feel my knees or my fingertips, and a house and a dog, maybe. Probably got a red bike when he was 10. Fuck do I care? I didn't know him. I didn't know his fucking dog. That same sixth gradeness existed in my voice now, and I try to exude nonchalance to smother it. But don't you wish you did? Don't you wish you knew his favorite type of flower, or if he double knotted his shoelaces, or Sophia, what if he loved someone?
Na 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 pictures snatched out the frame. Bitch, I scratched out your name and your face. What is it about you that I can't erase?
I stand over the toilet looking at my leftover dinner, the bits of orange pasta. I am taking care of myself, and I wonder if God did that on purpose, if pregnancy is a test for motherhood, if I must learn to clean myself before someone else. But vomit hangs on my hair, and although it comes from my mouth, it somehow manages to become my morning perfume. And I lay in the bathtub, washing all the woman off of myself, but it clenches to my hips like a disease.
2 years of marriage built us into a routine. After work, we would both come home, forcing ourselves to stay awake through jokes. Victor reminded me of my sense of humor. When we had nothing else to say, he would hover over my pale body like a shadow. His limbs struggle to hold his weight. He is skinnier than American men.
I open my eyes underwater, staring into the cloudiness. It looks delicious, like a glass of milk. It is silent. It isn't loud like land with children crying or women praying or men being afraid of their own anger. I curl myself into a ball, wondering if this is what the baby feels inside of me. My parents raised us Catholic. They gave us routines on Sundays. My mother hung over the ironing board, pressing our pastel dresses, and she would lay my father's tie out on their bed. I was taught to be afraid of God, to take his body and his blood and nurse it within myself.
I believe him when he says he picked bananas in the fields of San Pedro Sula instead of going to school. When we walk down the street together, Latina girls look at me like I am undeserving. They are sisters and lovers to their men in a way I could never be. I don't feel guilty anymore, now that I've had Victor's baby. Lisette came at the great climax of our relationship. Now I want to hold her 2-year-old body more than his. She sleeps in between us at night.
My mother is a silent woman, a woman who never touched her children. When she decided to send me away, she carried on with her Sunday routines. She didn't have to look at my round stomach in the church pew.
He wants to expand our family. My mother warned me that is how a lot of Latino men are. And sometimes I feel he doesn't want to waste me, like he doesn't waste his food. The opportunity for me to have children who carry on his family's name. He wants to bring Honduras to America, but I can't have them growing up with the same pair of shoes on their feet just because he did. When I told him we had to get another abortion, I felt like a kid telling her parent she lost something again. And then there was a slapping with words.
The bathroom door opens and Jenna, my sister, walks in. She is tall and lean like our mother, a woman who walks as though she is leading a crowd. Her stomach is round and swollen like a grapefruit filled with juicy blood orange insides. She smells like suntan lotion and baby powder. She has spent one too many days under the sun. Her skin is like leather. Wrinkles have risen to the surface of her forehead. She is a mother and a wife. I was told one cannot be either without the other. A mother must be a wife. A wife must be a mother.
A seafood smell is leaking like gas into the apartment from the hallway. I just want to collapse on the bed, to drop like a weight. The only place I've ever run to was in my mind. And Victor, he runs away to cook at the restaurant. And later, he'll go to the pool hall with his friends. His mouth will be on fire from Hennessy. It's never worked as a stimulant for him, just something to hold on to. He stopped trying to hold on to me once he couldn't hold on to the life inside of me. I went alone to the abortion clinic today, the same one we went to a year ago for the first abortion. He knew that was the last one he would go to.
Jenna crouches to the floor, holding the bottom of her stomach with one hand and her lower back with the other. She releases a groan that carried the plastic shopping bags, her toddler, and the stroller up the apartment stairs. Her office is the bedroom, the bathroom, and the kitchen. She scrubs the house, hoping her husband will notice her day's work. She runs her fingers through my hair, untangling the knots. Her hands are not loving, but more condescending. It feels as though she is touching me to convince herself she is a good mother.
I just want to take the train to New Haven and rest my head on my grandfather's stubble cheeks. I used to spend all my childhood summers with him in his garden. The must from the wet earth would travel into the house. The cherry tomatoes he picked would burst in our mouths. After having Lisette, Victor and I have lived out of the corner store. And sometimes he slips and he dictates me like my grandfather did with my grandmother. Men having their tantrums. But my grandfather remembered that this woman bore his children. When he apologized, he said he didn't know the person, he just was. I miss when Victor was grateful to me for giving him his papers.
My baby's father persuaded my hips that they're worthy of being touched, but when we were done, I felt dried up. Like he soaked all the water out of me and left a little part of himself. He considered himself a man because he left me alone in the hotel room the next morning. He probably felt good about himself, almost refreshed. And then he'd return to his routine, which I don't even know because you can't ask a man any questions about himself after sex, since it's the only time they're able to love themselves. And he doesn't have to think, really think about our child, because he is not carrying her.
Are we both accomplices? To the same crime?
She is not a part of his body. She does not know what he craves or what his voice sounds like in the evening.
It just accidentally happened to have motherhood vacuum itself out of me. And today, in such a sterile place.
She knows that I sing when I am walking home and that I cry when I lay down. And he is not curious about her. When I told him that I was giving her up for adoption, he probably felt less guilty, released from the weight.
I feel like too many other women around the world who bleed and cramp for this.
But now I have to hold her inside of me for 9 months, feeling her kicks and her hiccups, and she is not real to him.
I bust the windows out your car, and no, it didn't mend my broken heart. I'll probably always have these ugly scars, but right now I don't care about that part.
What do you want from me? I work for you. I bring things home. I listen when you talk about your mother. Women never accept what we give them.
After I saw you laying next to her, I didn't want to, but I took my turn. I'm glad I did it, cause you had to learn.
I wanted to see you cry. I asked you to show me. When we first met, you were quiet, mysterious even. Women always want a mystery, something for them to solve, and I told myself that if I could see you cry, I had solved that mystery. But how can I write about the unknown? I was once told to write about the culture that I know best. That culture is filled with the dangling breasts of women, my mother's elbow where I would fall asleep, my own fingers and how they hold so much but still look delicate. Mama says it's time to settle down to find a good girl. Is this girl the good girl she's talking about? If I have to question it, then she must not be. But I know she likes me. I see it when I lay over her in the afternoon after I make her quesadillas. How can we learn about men when they won't learn about themselves? My friend and I, we ask each other, who do men go to with everything? No one, that's the answer. So when I write about you, I can describe the way your eyes look at me. I know you keep secrets hidden behind your smile. You've told them to me. Slowly they slip from your lips. I know small things about your childhood, like that you slept on a church pew. I think you wanted me to pity you, to show me that you were a sensitive boy, a boy in need of help and affection. I know that your father was the first one to give you an art set. That was something I wanted to know. Lying in bed, I just wanted to know why art was important to you. But I can never capture you. I don't know who you are. She will work. In the end, she will give me a family. That is what I want. I know I shouldn't want that, but I never had stability. She will give that to me before she ends up hating me. What do you want?
I bust the windows out your car. You should feel lucky that that's all I did. After 5 whole years of this bullshit, you really hurt me, baby. You really hurt me, babe.
You can call it, but you can't use my phone.
JJ, I don't think Aunt Mabel and Cousin Shauna like you, or some of the other family members that come around either. My cousin Anya was 13 and I was 12. That was the first time I've ever heard my cousin so serious. I wasn't surprised because of what she told me. I already felt and knew, but I still had to ask, how can you be so sure? We were on Florida Avenue heading to my Aunt Dollar's house. My Aunt Dollar's house was like a sanctuary for my family. You get off work, you go to Aunt Dollar's house. Get off school, you go to Aunt Dollar's house. Want to gossip and have a good drink? You go to Aunt Dollar's house. Any and everything took place at her house. When I went over my aunt's house, it was like my way of being my actual self, because I was surrounded by love and family. At least that's what I thought it was. It was like the house had a personality of its own, peaceful and calm. But someone changed my view of that house very quickly. My Aunt Mabel was evil. She hated everything about me. She hated my clothes. She hated my size. And let's just keep it real, she hated my skin. One day, I just looked back and asked myself, what's the difference between me and my other cousins who she adored? And I realized that all my other cousins are either half Korean, half white, or just plain old light skin. Or who does she like? The only darkie. The only one who reminded her of where she came from. But that wasn't even why I was so upset. She would do stuff that just got under my skin. Like, it would be Easter, and she would give all my other cousins Easter eggs and baskets and toys, and not me. It would be Halloween, and she would get all my other cousins candy and start-off bags and makeup for their costumes. But where was my candy? Where was my makeup? My makeup. Where was my makeup? She called me the slow one because I would rather talk about poetry than talk about what boys I wanted to have sex with. I guess to her that was natural teenage conversation. But not to me. I had goals, dreams, morals. I wanted to be a writer, become something more than an old maid who enjoyed terrorizing little kids. But to Aunt Mabel, that just wasn't a real career. Thank God for my eldest cousin, Anya, because if it wasn't for her, I would have drowned in my own tears from the wicked tongue of Aunt Mabel. My Aunt Dollar had a dog named Jasper. And so anytime Aunt Mabel would hurt me verbally or mentally, I would go on the steps and cry. And I guess Jasper became my new Anya because every time he saw me, he would come and sit right next to me. Jasper died when I turned around the age of 11. When Jasper died, it was like the house I once adored became more like prison. Since my mom had to work and I was a minor, I couldn't stay at home all by myself. And so I tried a different strategy with Aunt Mabel. Anything she said or did, I complimented it. I didn't care if I didn't agree. So when my cousin asked me, or she was about to tell me what they were about to say about me, I said cold and brutal as a 5-ton elephant fell off my back. You know what, Anya? I really don't care. And I was free.
Get your shit and get out.
My mother tells me that my grandmother never loved her first husband.
He always finds his way back, though, becoming a hologram of a father just to get back through the door.
He was white, fat, and demanded she fed him every hour. She used him for money. And when she emptied his pockets, she got a restraining order. When he found her, he beat her near death. After he moved out the projects, they reconciled. Only for him to introduce her to crack. Mommy says that women in her country would do anything a man wants them to for American citizenship. She ran away. He found a new wife. I don't know which came first. Then she met a man named Frank. He felt like a new beginning, too. He had curly hair that was always saturated with cheap gel and a stomach that hung over his pants. Frank was a quiet man. He only spoke when he got drunk and stayed at my grandmother's side whenever we went to their house. They were still living in New York when he first cheated. My mother met my father at a club. He was nice. But mommy says men are always nice at first. He worked for the FBI, went to college, and said he could get her the same shoes he wore. Mommy had on flip-flops. She moved in with him because she had nowhere else to stay. She loves telling the story of how he bought her her first cell phone. He was her first everything.
He used to tickle me so he could see my smile, he said. But it was to prove that he knew where I was ticklish, to prove that he knew something about me. His smile seemed of pride, glazed with the satisfaction of not being a deadbeat like his father. In the 5 years of my life he was present, he bought me a green shirt from a DC tourist truck and a pair of rainbow sparkled sneakers that hugged my toes too tight. His visits became more infrequent after he punched my mother.
They never got married. He cheated on her with the lady from my barrio who cornrowed my hair. She said she needed space and moved all the way to New York to find it. When I was two, she met a man named Randy. Randy is a construction worker. In my grandma's apartment, he built a clear wax wall. On Valentine Street, he painted different shades of orange and brown to match my mother's paintings of mangoes and coco. Randy treated me as his fourth child for 12 years, but after they broke up and I stayed with my mother instead of visiting him for winter break, Randy was back to three.
That's when the custody battle began. He lost, of course, him being at a fourth grade reading level and deciding to represent himself in court. A month later, he told me he was going to New York, but he didn't come back for two of my birthdays, spending the time he didn't spend with me selling drugs.
Eventually, he stopped calling for my siblings to visit. Sometimes, I think he disowned all my siblings because of me. Ma, Randy affected all of us. You were the one that taught me that boys don't play with Barbies. But he choked me till my face was purple when I wouldn't give Luigi my doll. I cried all night that time you kicked him out, even though we both knew he would be back. At least he held you some nights. What did I get?
Visiting the prison was like a strange exhibit in a museum. His face behind the glass, heavy, taking up the air surrounding it. Unfamiliar hairs grew from his cheeks and above his blackened lips. The white wall behind his head felt empty, and dreads hung down to his shoulders, where before, stiff, kinky hair stood above his head.
I want to be able to remember his name when I tell my children who I first fell in love with. I want to be able to show them that men are kind and that in my family a cycle is broken. And I told you this. I told you that my father cheated on my mother. I told you that he would lay up with other women for hours and sprawl his drunk body on my mother's after. And you promised you were different. Mommy didn't tell me how much it hurt. This breed of sadness doesn't go away. It was the type that spilled into her children and formed potholes in their cheeks, dimples so deep that it hurts a smile. But I tried anyway.
He licked his lips, which later tightened into a smile, revealing his gold front tooth. I smile, but I didn't know this man. This man could have been the father to another little girl, but he couldn't have been mine. Hey, Halle Berry, he said as I put my ear to the cold, black phone. His voice sounded familiar, almost choked as I greeted him back. Hi, Daddy. His nose flared as he chuckled. I recognized that look in the mirror. He'd always loved seeing his features on my face. It was like proof to him, something undeniable. You be good and listen to your mommy. I anticipated this conversation all night, and it ended within 3 minutes. But the silence was painful, and the only sound came from the shuffling of chairs beside us. Later that week, during a trip to the grocery store with my mother, she told me my father had been deported. Her voice sounded rehearsed, and her lips were white as she pressed them together, and I knew better than to ask questions. So instead, I begged for a box of Fruityos that she had never gotten me before. She dropped them in the cart without a fight.
You were the first person I wanted to love. On Sundays, we made our own sanctuary. I bought a map of the world's constellations. You got your license. Overdue library books on Greek mythology cluttered your backseat. Every week you bought more. We first met on alphabet carpets when I wore pink dresses. Your hands were covered in paint and dried glue. Your face covered in layers of Vaseline put on by your mother to cover any evidence of ash. I walked up to you because it reminded me of cooking pans on Sundays. You would draw a picture of the moon. I draw a house. We pretended that we understood each other's drawing. You taught me to play Pokemon. I taught you to steal tickets from Chuck E. Cheese. You were the last person to treat me like a girl. Do you remember when we started to study the story behind each constellation? Your favorite was Canis Minor. You'd always find a way to talk about the winemaker's dog, who after witnessing his owner's murder, jumps out a window. But I never had the guts to tell you that all I ever saw were dots. They soon became my favorite too. Summer came and we began to change. I started to hate the way the heat wrapped around my skin, burning my hands into the grass. You hated the way mosquitoes made love to your skin and the way the back of my grandfather's truck burned your legs. But every week we met with grass and mosquitoes lying there for hours. I told you about my father and how we only seemed to find our numbers on Christmas or when he was in need and feeling like a man, but was nowhere to be found on Christmas, but was nowhere to be found in hospitals or late at night when mom would lock herself in the bathroom to cry, thinking no one could hear her. You were the only one that knew that my worst fear wasn't to become unspeakably depressed with the world on her shoulders like my mother. It was to become sick, dependent on a bottle like him.
I smell the smell and I don't look down. The carpet is moist and wet and I don't know what I'm stepping on, but it's wrong. That reek and this darkness and the moisture, it's all wrong.
You'd rock yourself back and forth to sleep like you used to do during nap time at daycare. But your limbs were too long now, awkwardly folding, bending, pushing into one another, trying to make space out of flesh and bone. You once told me how much you hated dinner with your parents. How you hated the sound of metal hitting glass over and over again, so we never used them.
The kitchen is the center of the smell, rotten from the inside, just like her. I can't stay, not even if I try. Repulsed and lost in a sea of boxes and boxes and boxes and boxes.
That you hated weekends with your grandparents. That you hated when your parents would leave you alone with your grandparents. So I never told you that my mom could no longer afford the house, no matter how many prayers she said to God. I just left. I didn't think of you much after I left. Not about the way you rocked yourself to sleep like a baby, or looked up at the sky like it would solve all your problems. We both grew to know it wouldn't. That no matter how much Vaseline you put on your face, you would never shine as bright as the constellations. A few weeks ago, I saw you at the park down the street from your house. I didn't recognize you at first. The way you smelled now reminded me of my father, a combination of malt liquor and peppermints. You gave me a hug, but I wanted nothing more but to get away from the smell.
I can't see 2 feet in front of my toes. The books that topple over as my shins rub by are older than me. Ancient and preserved in dusty filth. The smell is a cocktail. Bottles of Smirnoff and Johnny Walker cling together as my feet drag past. I see the mug. It is always full of tea, apparently, except it isn't. Gin and bourbon and whiskey, that is her mug, and that is her tea. It gives that rancid smell in the air a punch. Something tells me to slap the mug. It flies, disappearing between the towering pillars of junk, and the sound of that little dog yapping into the grimy air stabs me in the ear. Little shit dog, we call it. Not her, though. She loves it like she loves Jack Daniels as he falls down her throat. I see it run past, a fluffy blur as it jumps from clutter to clutter, the narrow path I'm walking, more an obstacle than the trash around me. It lives in this jungle, that little shit dog. It knows it here. She loves it because it knows it here, in her home. Flaking paint falls on my head and rolls down my neck in dry showers that remind me of dead flower petals. I hope it's paint. A brand new lawnmower, an antique lampshade, dozens of American Girl dolls, untouched by anything but dirt, time, and a hint of guilt, all packed away in boxes, and I walk up the stairs trying to make not a noise, desperate not to knock over any of her bottles or her cans or her toys. Little shit dog is stuck in my head. It's barking and yapping, crawling around on my brain. Too scared to touch anything, too disgusted to look away. What's that? First time I see wall in this house, and I pray to God that the wallpaper is just strange, and that whatever's on that wall isn't vomit. But I know her, and I know better. I feel like I might vomit. She would notice. And that smell, even up here on the second floor, attacks my insides with a ravenous violence. There's a light at the end of this hall. His door is wide open. Grandfather's. The Coast Guardsman. The loving father. The scammer and the cheater. My grandfather. In his room, I see his ship. The model. His pride and joy. I touch it because he hates that. Because who will stop me? And because the smooth feel of that wooden starboard. But even in here, there is an endless pile of boxes. And there is that smell. My eyes water, and I see him at his desk, and I see his Oxford dictionary and his scratches and his glasses with those scratches which infect the lenses so casually. I see him warmly watching us, and I feel him rubbing my hair and cupping the back of my neck with his hand. That smile that always crept across his cheeks when his children brought him their own. Little shit dog. It yaps and it barks and it pees on his bed, looking me in the face while it does it. This was his home and his prison, his life and his death. She kept him here, boxed in, with that mug, with the smell, with that little shit dog. Take your pick, she says, her lips beside my head, her words scratching out from somewhere broken and ruined, her third layer of lipstick staining her somehow yellowing dentures. It's yours, she says. I look at and watch that model ship, which shines so proudly among the shadows that clot every corner of this room, of this house, her house. It's yours, she says. I see him reaching up and reaching high and pulling that ship down to show his grandchildren the one possession he has that reminds him of his life, his real life, not this. I see him in his bed, pale and cold, his breath relieved of its duties. There's no knife in his back, no bullet in his head, there's no poison in his blood, but he was murdered there in that piss-covered bed. It's what he would have wanted, she says. And I know she doesn't know, and the words burn in my throat as the water falls out of my face. And she rubs my shoulders and looks in my eyes. But all I see is his cell, his prison, which she so intricately built for him. All I see is him alone, surrounded by an ocean of boxes and boxes and boxes.
So my name is Anna Benefiel, and I flew to D.C. for the Women's March on Washington from Dallas, Texas. I came here because I'm, of course, extremely troubled by Trump's stated agenda. After the election, I was really crushed because I thought that the America that I knew had disappeared, had gone away, hadn't made its voice known. And so the coat actually has a lot of messages from Dallas. And I asked people that I didn't know, that I just was connected to on social media, to help me put messages on this coat. They couldn't come, so I wanted to come and bring their messages because they can't be physically present here where maybe our voices will be heard by members of Congress or the new administration in the White House. So they created these for me. This person sent this clip to me in snail mail. Like this is a piece of her shirt for her little boys. And, you know, she believes that love trumps hate and that her boys, 3 and 1, deserve a better role model. And as a mother of children who are 2 and 4 years old, I completely agree.
I used to see God in weird places.
I used to see God in weird places.
Like the lines of my palms or the rearview mirror of my mother's old car. I told my father about this. He was a pastor for 22 years. He told me that the Lord resides in the scripture, not your imagination. And I would try to explain that at that age, I wasn't literally seeing a kind, bearded man in the lines of my palms or in rearview mirrors, but he just tossed the Bible in front of me and told me to copy verses. This isn't a punishment. Most people will call my father a good man. He never smoked, lost his virginity to my mother. I don't think he ever touched another woman in his life. When he hit me, he kept his fist loose, so it felt more like a good push. In elementary school, all the other kids would complain about the beatings they get from their fathers. And you could tell if they got hit the night before, too, because they'd show up to school and they'd sit on their hands and stare at the empty worksheets on their desks. But my father stopped after kindergarten. Instead, he would bring out this family Bible thicker than my head and read to me the story of Isaac and Abraham. It was weird to hear him read the Bible like it was a book and not like Sunday mornings. Then God said, "Take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah. Take him as a sacrifice on a mountain I will show you." Now that I think about it, that's a weird story to read with your father. But I got his point. When he was finished, he wouldn't say anything. He just gave me a look that felt like the man had taken me by the leg and swung me into the wall. And he preached like that, too. He took each verse, loaded them into the chamber, and opened fire into the congregation. And I would look around when he was finished, expecting bodies. But all I saw were smiling faces. He was good. Babies would never cry when he preached. I remember one day after one of his Easter sermons, a man in a white suit came up to him and said, "With the way you preach, you ought to run for office." He would have hated that. Without the need for a sermon, my father had very little to say. So he smiled politely. He thanked the man. He said he had already found his life's work. And then he put his arm around my shoulder. And he said, "This boy too, gotta pass it on." And then he pulled me in for one of those weird half hugs. And I felt the stubble of his neck graze my cheek. That's probably my favorite memory of him.
On Sunday mornings, daddies walk down to the water. They make bets about street rats who fight over food meant for domesticated animals, anything to get them out of the house.
You tell him he's just like his uncle. Hands calloused, fingernails bitten, eyes dark and blind, beer belly bloated with love.
Mommies hide crucifix necklaces under silk bras shown only to their husbands and a bartender who pays for love with liquid courage.
You make him think he's following his path. Too many friends, never likes to be alone, never looks at himself all the way. I thought that since he's your son, you wouldn't do that to him.
Children with enough money for school spend days in the dirt, while the children deemed poor pull plastic bags up 4 to 5 flights of stairs every day without question. Teacher watches these children. He fantasizes about bad young girls whose punishments are doled out after Jesus is placed in a drawer, only after Jesus is placed in a drawer. Across the street, preacher yells at men who pretend to listen. God punishes the wrong.
God punishes the wrong.
God punishes the indecent.
God punishes the indecent.
But it is he who on his break sits on a stiff wooden bench behind the curve of mommy's breast in the mouth of her little girl, releasing the day onto a white robe meant only for faith. His hands will not be clean for the little girl's baptism. Preacher loved mommy in the mornings. He came after little girls left for school. He would return after mommy left for work. Mommy always seemed to work late. I'm like Santa. 5-year-old eyes couldn't see the difference between a large red man who brought gifts and the shape she could feel pressing into her lower back when he made her sit on his lap, she would never scream.
He would never scream.
She knew what Santa did when little girls were bad. That mommies would come home to bruised arms and split lips. She knew that mommy never had the guts to question. She knew that little girls were only safe at school. Until teacher found her crying in the back of the room, he locked the doors, rolled down the blinds, and placed Jesus in a drawer so that the Savior's eyes could be shielded from the punishments that would proceed throughout the week. She was pretty sure Santa could see her from the window. He would lean on a small tree that could barely handle the weight of his neck, much less the rest of his body. Do you know why I love you? I love you because you are mommy, mommy without the extra words. I love you because when mommy fights back, you are there when I need you. I love you because when mommy says no, you are there. Because baby, I will always need you. It made her wonder if mommy knew. That maybe, just maybe, mommy didn't know that her little girl came home to little white sweets that brought sleepy clouds over her eyes. Maybe mommy didn't know that she couldn't get up in the morning because of the pain between her legs. Maybe if mommy knew, she would come home. She would curl up next to her little girl like she used to. She would give her kisses, sweet, sweet kisses that left cracked lipstick stains on her forehead. But no. Instead it was, "Don't forget, baby. Mommy loves you. God watches over you. Jesus died for you, and preacher works to make us happy."
You don't know why you say that boy is like his uncle. You look at his smile. You remember how his teeth looked like before he had braces like crowded lunch lines. You don't know about him skipping after school in fourth grade, got kicked out and ain't tell you. Found pocket knives inside of a jacket he seen and lost and found. Went to go slash ties with friends on Columbia Road. You remember his father, how he took care of him on Saturdays. You remember his father and how he didn't know how to be one. Not because he was a vagabond or because he was an addict. Cigarettes alone won't get you into hell. Your son ain't no bastard. You'd come home from house cleaning and find the boy's butt red with rashes in the arms of his father too far off into sleep. He was a man with morals. Principles either from his own father, who by the way hates football and African bees, or the Holy Bible. He's seen 9 boys grow up, get beatings, and cry again, age like leather. For 9 years, you walked that boy to school every day. You'd be rich if you weren't a mother. Remember the first gift that boy got his father? A necktie, he don't wear those, should have got him a wallet or something. Remember his first fist fight? Then the first time he bucked at his father, first time he ever wanted to kill another man, first woman he slapped. First baptism, first time he felt smoke burn the back of his throat, first time he chugged alcohol and liked it. First girl he loved other than his mother, first time he made sure no one found reason to leave him because he did drugs, first time he quit. First woman that left him, first girl he called a bitch. First time he realized that any role model he ever had was a sex offender. First time he fell asleep and you could not wake him up. First repentance he'd been feeling since he was 12 that he don't belong. That boy ain't cry when he was born too early. He'd hear God laughing at him, ain't shit been funny. Keep telling him he needs to talk to someone, but how he supposed to tell the men he lives with that he's hurt? That he been abused, that somehow he affected. Don't be no pussy. How you date a girl for 7 months and ain't fucked? He talk a lot about his uncle because of you. Never met the man. Probably run around thinking he'll die in the hands of his best friend same way his uncle did. That's no way for a man to live. How is he okay with that?
From the perspective of the people on the bus, it was just a rundown apartment suitable for single mothers with disabilities. The children's playground marked in graffiti. Nicknames in Fifth Street scribbled on the slab. More nicknames written in chalk in the alley. Trash all over the playground. For a long time, I couldn't even tell which door was the front or back because we rarely used the front door. They tore the lock off the back one, so the residents didn't need a key to get in. Plus, it was closer to the Five and Dime, or Pops, the neighborhood corner stores. The Five and Dime had a nice lady that worked there. I think she was Chinese. I used to hate that damn smile on her face. My mom would feel generous on some days and let me and my older brother get 50-cent snacks. We couldn't read numbers at the time, so he'd pick up a 50-cent zebra cake and a 75-cent donut stick. Before my mom could take the item and return it, the Chinese lady stepped from behind the counter. "No, no, it's okay. He can have both for free," she would say. "I wanted some donut sticks. What about me?" I asked. He looked at me. "Why didn't you pick up a donut stick?" "Slow. Slow. I hate when people call me slow." He didn't have a gifted wisdom like I did to catch on to the bigger picture. Last week, Mom handed him the phone when our aunt called. She called him the pretty one, and she didn't even ask to speak to me. "She gave you that donut stick because you white, you light-skinned faggot." We started to throw fists. I was faster, so I landed clean hits to his face, but he was older than me, so the ones that hit me really hurt. It was a fair fight. We both were stubborn. He was determined to prove he was a grown man, but I wasn't going to live in his shadow. That Chinese lady was something special. She stepped in between us. "What are you doing? Stop that right now. Here, you want a donut stick too?" She knew that a small moment like this could turn a little boy power hungry, so she made me feel equal to my older brother. Everything changed when her husband died. I never saw her smile again. Most of the kids in the building attended the same school. We didn't like DCPS lunch, so on the way home, we stood outside her store, asking strangers who passed by for change. When we had enough, we bought some snacks. On some days, I would give her more money than I needed to, but nothing made her smile. She looked tired. Her head was always down. She said she was closing for renovation, but it became a liquor store. The rage I felt was excruciating, but whatever it was about her smile that made me feel equal to my brother would always walk beside me. I learned to forget her. The parents in the building were getting more comfortable letting the kids play outside with no supervision. My mom would send me and Twan to Pop's dollar store to pick up her cigarettes. Sitting at the counter, legs crossed, Pops looked upon his notepad, checking the amount we owed. The date set for us to pay him had passed. He glared at us. "I told your mom already not to be sending y'all kids down here." I could hardly control myself. Twan yanked me by the shoulder. "Calm down, Pudgy. I would be mad too. Money ain't no joke, bro. Man, get off me." He still didn't see the bigger picture. The Chinese lady didn't care as much about money, and Pops didn't either, or he wouldn't have let us pay on credit. But our mom felt like she can't do anything without smoking the cigarette first. The problem starts because you need something to suppress your suffering, so you begin to value objects over human life. Pops cared about the neighborhood, but when his wife got mad at how little money was coming in, she made him choose between her or the way he ran the store. Pops decided to do things differently. We had to tell him what we wanted at the front and wait while he would go get it. I thought he was going to have a heart attack walking with that cane. "I don't like that guy no more," I tried to warn Twan. "He's changed. As did my perspective of the world. I questioned myself, is everyone like Pops, man?" Periodically, fights would break out between the adults in my building. They usually fought over rumors and gossip, someone talking behind another's back. Man, I wish being a kid was a good enough reason to stop the chaos. Kids in the building would say something stupid to their parents, like, "Miss Sharon looked at me funny." Then all hell broke loose. Moms banging on each other's doors. "What you say about my son? Stop playing. My son ain't like that. Don't play with me." The next day, all of us kids would meet up outside and complain about our moms trying to find reason to adapt and forgive each other. They singled Miss Davis out. She would call the police on us snitching. The hallway and playground is where the teenagers sit to roll their weed. The smell gets in my house. They're so damn disrespectful. They need to be dealt with. There was a common enemy. My friends would mess with her after the police left. Again, everyone missed the bigger picture. I spoke to Ms. Davis. I said hi when I saw her. She asked me a couple questions, and she thought I was the intelligent one because I had dreams instead of goals. One time, she asked me, "What do you want to be when you're older?" My response, "Rapper." She never spoke to me again. It doesn't matter, I'm with the squad. Forget Ms. Davis, her old ass. You know what I'm saying? I rarely had conflict with any of the kids or parents. I kept a low profile and helped solve most of the disputes. I wouldn't call it leadership, though. The leaders in my building were my older brother, Twan, and Fat Paul. Twan knew how to finesse people. It made us great partners, and that's why I love him. I never seen Fat Paul fight or argue with anyone in the building. He was cool with everyone. I had to learn his secret. As much as I would love to control the world around me, it wasn't my time yet. Some nights, us kids would just sit on those first touchscreen cell phones, scrolling down, looking at the girls. Me and Twan had prepaid cell phones, so we looked on with them. She looked all right, I hit that jump. They could do it all night. After I got bored of seeing different girls do the same damn pose in all the photos, I stepped off. I guess that's why my friends were always 10 girlfriends ahead of me. But I could see straight through the sweet talk and flattery. In reality, my brothers treat them like objects. The object I valued was money. Obviously, I had none, so I was stealing pocket knives from corner stores for moves. I heard some white guys were trying to move into the neighborhood. They moved in only to get their tires slashed, and they learned not to carry cash, but we take credit cards too. You can't destroy this place. I got dreams to stay right here and build an empire. To my family, this building isn't ordinary public housing, even though the paint was peeling and the kitchen walls were covered in grease. I remember my old pal from school, Joppy, when he first moved into the building, apartment number 31, which in fact was my old sanctuary until the living room ceiling collapsed. Our landlord was out of town that week, so our only option was to transfer everything next door into number 32. A couple weeks later, I'm helping Joppy unpack. Joppy taught me not to lie to myself, to speak up when it's necessary, because I am strong enough to fight anything that threatens my dreams. I was also participating in mentors of minorities at the time, so I was routinely practicing meditation, self-awareness, debug strategies, taking rap a little more seriously. If I got money, it was going to family or studio time. I was ready to tell my story, to give the world everything. But despite the wisdom I share, it's useless because they're already happy with their objects. I hate happy people. Happy people are ignorant of everything. I was jealous because when they take a shower, they didn't have to worry about the pipes being dysfunctional, shit coming out instead of water. When they purchase and bring a pet home, it becomes part of the family and treated as a human equal. Literally, though, I remember seeing a white man wipe his dog's ass with his hand, then sniff the motherfucker. What's wrong with these people, man? Treat the animals better than they treat actual human beings. They don't need me. They live in a world I can't even fathom. When I find cats on the street and bring them in my house, they learn to eat roaches and mice. We train dogs to be aggressive and to feed off of our hatred for the ignorant who think they don't need to worry. I remember Fat Paul's first dog, a dark black female pit bull named Darkness.
And the sun is rising over streets so barren since the evening. Colors flash before my eyes.
We took her outside. When Miss Davis walked by, first thing Fat Paul said to it, Darkness, bite her ass.
I feel like a child so young and new in 92. I listen to what my father said.
What should Darkness have against Miss Davis?
Keep all your dreams, keep standing tall.
At that moment, I realized the secret I've hidden for so long,
if you are strong, you cannot fall,
was ready to emerge.
There is a voice inside us all, so smile.
Fighting for the people you love is much harder than fighting against the people you hate.
When you can, all this used to feel so far and free. Now these broken souls are all I see. Fists have fallen to our sides. We may cry alone. I feel we know where all of this is headed. But my mama said, keep all your dreams, keep standing tall. If you are strong, you cannot fall. There is a voice inside us all, so smile, oh, when you can. You're broken down and tired of living life on a merry-go-round.
You can't find a fighter, but I see it in you, so we gon' walk it out. Move mountains. We gon' walk it out and move mountains. And now silence is a quiet, and it feels like it's getting hard to breathe. And I know you feel like dying, but I promise we'll take the world to its feet. Move mountains, bring it to its feet. Move mountains. That we have each other. A thousand times again.